Food is a very much quoted subject in medical medieval literature, both in theoretical books for college and in more practical works whose aim is to preserve health and prevent or cure disease. This issue is not new, since as early in the 5th century BC, several books from the Hippocratic corpus already put the emphasis on the therapeutic and prophylactic role of food and on the necessity to regulate people's diet so they could remain healthy. The treatise on ancient medicine even dated back the origin of medicine to the invention of cooking and in the capacity of determining which type of food was most likely to feed mankind, to help it grow and stay fit, thanks to adequate culinary preparations. However, food really started to occupy a new place in medical talks from the 2nd century AD, with Galen and the medieval authors who were writing in Arabic and were the heirs of the Greek thinking. Food was then considered as being part of the necessary things, necessary or non-natural things, expression which refer to a whole combination of factors that are instrumental in being healthy. Different, as you can see, from the natural things or physiological components of man and from the unnatural things or disease, these factors constitute one of the parts of practical medicine, which is dietetic, along with pharmacopoeia and surgery. Whether physiological, psychological, or linked to the environment, they include air, food and drink, exercise and rest, sleep and waking, repletion and excretion, emotions or passions of soul, but also bleeding, bathing, and sex. They were considered by medieval doctors who read Galen and the Encyclopedia, written in Arabic, as elements indispensable to life, but also as risk factors, if I may say so. If the word risk is not literally used in the medical terminology, the author insists on the ambiguous part played by food, both necessary to growth and life, but also potentially dangerous if not adapted to the constitution of the one who resorts to it. This subtle reflection, which was taught in the antiquity, continued and developed in the Middle Ages, both with the author from the Arabo-Islamic world and those from Latin Occidental world. It was continued in a large range of works with different aims. If the commentary of the works taught in university insists on the ambivalent nature of food, both nutriment, a safer medicine than pharmacopoeia, but also a potential risk, the more didactic works aimed at a learned audience, albeit no part of the medical world, attempt to divulge an elementary knowledge about food. Through the use of diets, they offer their readers a kind of education to food before its time, so that this reader could choose the most adequate food for them. Just like air, food is essential to life and enables, as Galen showed in his definition of digestion, to build up again the lost corporal substance and also what has been evacuated from the body. This is made possible thanks to the process of food transformation, which occurs in a complex way during digestion. This phenomenon is present in detail by the Persian author Avicenna in his 5-volume medical encyclopedia, the Canon, who was translated into Latin in Toledo in the 12th century by Gerard of Cremona. It soon became one of the essential texts in medical teaching. In the first book devoted to physiology and the non-natural things, digestion was presented as a mechanical process made up of a series of cooking in different parts of the body. Here you have a diagram which summarizes Avicenna's thought. Such a cooking enables a progressive alteration of food and its mutation into corporal matter. Gradually, the undigested and useless matters are expelled from the body in the form of urine, menstruation, sweat, sperm, and even feces. After a first transformation inside the mouth, which permits to reduce the food into small particles. The latter go down to the stomach, where a second digestion occurs. The food are changed into chyle. Inside the liver, the boiling chyle is divided into more or less cooked solid matters, which in turn produce the humors that spread through different parts of the body, the blood to the veins and the arterioles and the heart, the yellow bile to the bladder, for instance. A final digestion regenerates all the tissues, the flesh, the bones, the nerves. So that digestion could be made easy, a long process, you see, which requires a lot of heat and to cook the food, and that the body rejects less superfluity, people must choose a type of food whose nature is similar to the consumer's. In the ancient medical way of thinking, which grant every species of the sublunar world, that animal, vegetals, mineral species, with a complexion, that's to say a combination of the basic qualities that are cold, heat, moist, and dryness, a person with a choleric complexion, that is hot and dry, dominant characteristics, for instance, feeds himself with a type of food that possesses the same qualities. Such easily digested food allows to reinforce the natural constitution of a person and of their health, which precisely correspond to a balanced combination of these qualities inside the body. However, this simple vision of food is made complex by the liberal perception of health. If being healthy comes down to a perfect balance of dryness, heat, moist, and cold, and if disease are regarded as the opposite, in reality, doctors consider that a universal state of health does not exist. Only deteriorated states exist. The choleric, phlegmatic, sanguine, melancholic tempers are sometimes considered natural and thus healthy, sometimes unnatural in the balance is the imbalance is too strong and that unhealthy. These relative states of health vary throughout life, and you see that old ages lead to a natural loss of heat and humidity, which were the main characteristic of growth and youth. It makes elderly people cold and dry. People's gender, seasons, and the activities do also have an influence on the combination of basic qualities. It's then the doctor's job to determine if the patients are healthy or ill, using all these parameters, and to advise the patients to eat a particular food or type of food which would correspond to their constitution. Therefore, food is likely to play a double role, that of simple food to stay fit, or that of medicine inside the therapeutic frame. This double nature of the foodstuff, which also distinguishes it from the other non-natural things whose therapeutic role is less assertive, justifies the necessity to follow the doctor's recommendation. An inadequate diet is indeed a risk whose effect on the body is immediate and lasting, since the foodstuff can, in that case, alter the natural constitution. This risk is dual, either quantitative or qualitative. In the first case, it's a matter of either eating too much or fasting too much. The latter is not very often mentioned, and it's much more the gula which is criticized. A gula which is a reference less to the sin of gluttony in the theological meaning than to the pleasures of good food, the spicy courses, the profusion of the dishes, which at the end of the Middle Ages embody the status symbol of the social class. To the gula of the moderns, doctors oppose the ancient frugalitas, hence health, that is one frugal, simple meal without complicated preparations which answer only to natural needs. They also insist on the necessity to eat three times within 2 days and never to eat beyond one digestive capacity. Here, for instance, a quotation from a dietetic book written by the Italian physician Giacomo Albini in the 14th century. He explained that philosophers, that is, people who are not involved in manual works, need only 3 meals within 2 days. The preservation of health, for an author like John of Toledo, who wrote in his regimen about 1250, For him, conservation of health is the conservation of the stomach, to eat what you can digest and not more. As for the qualitative danger, it's about the choice of the food, which, according to the doctors, do not always all have the same nature. Some are hot and moist, and health hot and dry, according to a 4-degree scale. According to these qualities, and also to their substance, their appearance, or even to the method of production, the practitioners include within the each and varieties a hierarchy according to the respective nutritional properties of the different foodstuff. Cereal and meat are put at the top of the list for their nutriment, but are not recommended for everybody. The last sea floors, which only digest less quickly, or the red meat, more nourishing, are in that way recommended to the one who practice manual works, while the meat of bird and the white red breads are recommended for the idle elite and also for sick people because of the easier digestion. Such, for example, in this treaty, it's not a very beautiful manuscript, but it's a burnt manuscript, but it's a manuscript of dedication of this book written by Giacomo Albinis for the Lord of Acai, James, in the 30s. So he says here that people who are involved in manual activities like carpenters or craftsmen need thick food in the sense of nourishing food. One can see here that the elementary diet and the medical representation of diet meet the form of social hierarchies where the scientific discourse also prioritizes the most expensive food products reserved for the aristocracy. But a bigger danger in the elementary choice comes from the fact that some types of food are less useful in feeding than in correcting individual complexion. Like medicines, these products, whose constitution is not very temperate, provide not a lot of corporal substance, but on the other hand, transform the consumer's constitution. This differentiation within the alimentary class was already present in the work of the 10th century Arab author Ali ben al-Abbas al-Majuzi. Constantine the African translated his work in the 11th century at Mount Cassino. His Pantegni became the first medical encyclopedia written in Arabic and translated and quickly disseminated in the Latin world. The author distinguished there between what he called simple foods, and what he considered medicine food, cibi medicinali. He explained that quotation that during the digestive process, the first one, the simple foods, because of their nature close to human nature and of a balanced constitution, turn themselves totally into corporal substance and do not reject a lot of superfluous things. On the other hand, the other one, that is the cibi medicinali, the food medicine, whose constitution is more unbalanced because, for instance, they are very hot or very dry, like some spices or some seasoning herbs, or too cold and too moist, like some fruit, are less similar to food than to remedial materia medica. This distinction, which can be found in Avicenna's work and his commentary, brings into opposition cereal and animal species, or dairy products and condiments, and especially fruit. With the exception of dates and figs, fruit, according to medieval physicians, should never be eaten as foodstuff for the preservation of health, but only with the aim of remedial or prophylaxis actions. The Byzantine doctor Theodore, who wrote a letter of health for the Emperor Frederick II, summarized this idea in that way: Fructibus ut medicamentis utere, use fruits as medicine because of their laxative or astringent effects. Arnaldo Villanova, who wrote a very important text, very most diffused, at the beginning of the 14th century for the king of Aragona, suggests the same idea. Because of these laxative or astringent effects, fruit are not to be used as food, but as medicine to correct people's complexion. Unlike traditional materia medica, which causes problems of dosage or correct proportions and can be dangerous, food generate effects that are sometimes similar without jeopardizing the consumer's health. The poor nutritional quality of the medicine food is often linked to too present a humidity, which makes them hard to digest, that generate humors, which are likely to putrefy and to rot the body because they're not cooked, well cooked, and to produce fever. This ambivalence of diet that can sometimes be nutritional, sometimes remedial, linked to the very ambiguity of the nature of foodstuff, explains in part the emergence of a literature prone to didacticism and popularization, written for readers uninvolved in medical profession, but eager to know how to preserve their health. Food is then both a benefit and a danger, a nutritive substance and a main medicine. No wonder then to find regularly dietetic advice in medical books in order to go along with medical preparations, like in that example you can see on the screen. In these individual instructions, which are called consilia, written for individual patients, here two examples, one of Gentile da Foligno, who is an author of the 14th century from Perugia, and Ugo Benzi, practitioner from Siena in the 15th century. They wrote several consilia, more than 100 consilia, which are collected in manuscripts, and they often offered before recipes of medicine, dietary advice, in order to cure the passion of the pain. Here you have two kind of recipes with meat, for instance. Similarly, as early at the end of the 12th century, Salernitan doctor Petrus Musandinus wrote a rather successful treatise about the diet of sick people. But food undoubtedly took up a preponderant room in the literature of the Regimina, these treatises of vulgarization, which increased from the 13th century on amid non-natural things which provide the architecture of these texts. Some of them even proposed true alimentary catalogues. They enumerated the multiplicity of foodstuffs which could be eaten, added dictionaries, such as in this example of the compendium De Naturis et Proprietatibus Alimentorum of Barnabas Riattini from Reggio, and you see here the letter D, for instance, not the letter A, sorry, with all the products which are treated in this part of this dictionary. Another example of the same manuscript in Edinburgh National Library with an index of all the products that are more than 100 of food that are mentioned in the text. Another example is Michel Savonarole, Libretto de tutte le cose che si mangiano, the book of all the food that are eaten, which is written in the middle of 15th century for the Lord of Ferrara, Borso d'Este. Like the Taqwim al-Siyya of the Christian doctor from Baghdad, Ibn Butlan, dead in the 11th century, with dietary work translated in the 13th century under the title of Taquinum Sanitatis and widely distributed, present, as you can see, on the Arabic manuscript and also a Latin manuscript of the same text, present the qualities of food with kind of list. This Latin diet text offered a wide range of knowledge about the edible varieties, their complexion, their effects, and about the way to cook them. Some authors, clearly influenced by the culinary art, didn't hesitate to give cooking advice in turn for improvement of the harmfulness of some products, like Maino of Maineri from Milan, professor at Paris University at the beginning of the 1930s. Here, preparation of fish, red mullets and gurnets, whether roast or fried, with a green sauce. You warm it up from the point of view of the complexion with strong spices in winter and cool it with vinegar in the spring. Or a variant with a sauce used in France, not yet, with mixed wine with ginger and with garlic in winter. Some other authors also adapt their remarks on the reality of the customs and insert in their discourse new consumers' goods, like citrus fruit, which begin to be regularly cultivated in the Italian peninsula and are used in culinary cooking or even pasta. The Catalan Arnold of Villanova, who wrote a regimen at the beginning of the 14th century, Barnabas Fiatinis, or also Michel Savonarole, allude to some typologies of pasta coming from a double tradition, an ancient one for the fresh pasta, an Arabic-Islamic one for the long-life pasta. Barnabas even proposed regional appellations, Tria of Ancona, Vermicelli of Tuscany, Oretti of Bologna, Vermicelli of Venice, Formentini of Reggio, Pancarvelli from Mantua. And here you have an illustration in Taquinum Sanitatis in Latin of the pasta Formentini made with wet, for instance. By adapting scientific knowledge to the realities of conceptions and by writing accessible books, sometimes in a native language, like the bestseller Livre de Physique or Régime du Corps of Aldobrandino of Siena in the middle of the 13th century, medieval practitioners spread beyond their professional community through their diets a set of general knowledge about food and a set of rules which must be followed in order to help to the conservation of the health. These texts, indeed, were intended mainly for aristocratic circles, as it appears with this list, only a small one because the literature of regimina is much more important. These lists, which indicate the addresses of some of these texts, they were passed around a lot within these circles, as was made clear with the preserved inventories of libraries, which bore witness of the frequent presence of one or several copies of regimina in the manorial or ecclesiastical libraries. These works, whose aim is didacticism and popularization, could have certain similarities with some kind of handbook of food education, and more widely with dietetic handbook, before the term was even coined. The tone of the first text written in the 13th century was generally injunctive, and the authors often wanted to impose rules to their readers, forbidding some conception or other. However, the tone of the later treatise became more and more open-minded. The author, sometimes regular visitors of their addresses, whose doctor they are, often took the takes and the appetites of the latter into account, because they know how difficult it was to impose rules where patients are in good health. Then the doctors, faced with the risk represented by some uses, suggest sometimes preparations which could preclude any danger of, in case of conception of some foodstuff. Advice and simple recommendation replace the rule, and above all the possibility of debating, left to the consumer with full knowledge on the fact and on the risk. When he spread this knowledge and claiming it was the only one to possess it, not only did the practitioner suggest advice to his reader, but in a way made him responsible for his own diet and thus for the preservation of his own health. Thank you for attention.
Thank you very much. Before we break up for lunch, any questions, comments?
I just studied the Yenchan Zhongyao, the Chinese text, which deals the dietary manual from 1340 in Mongol China. And listening to your lecture, Satori Mas, I just suddenly realized the whole thing is an Ibn Sina thing. Yes, there's lots of Chinese tradition, there's Mongol stuff, but for example, food prohibitions and how they interact, and we have wet nurse rules. We knew that was Ibn Sina. But I was going to use this as an example of how East Asian things, like in the Tansuk, move into Iran and the West. But now I suddenly realize the text is a shining example of Western influence on Chinese medicine. And so I had she'll appreciate the word Satori Mas. I woke up, I had a Zen experience. So there's another book you should have included. Except for the Han.
I have a question. Do you notice your authors, do they seem to care, is there a difference when they start to talk about the simple food versus medicinal food? Are they more specific in their descriptions of medicinal food because that's what they want to focus on as a way to shape people's behaviors or practices, or are they just as equal in simple food versus medicinal food?
I'm not sure I've understood what you say. Sorry, could you speak slowly?
Sorry.
No,
it's okay. And I'm a little sick, so it might be coming out loud. I'm just wondering, when you look at your authors and you spoke about simple food versus medicinal food, do the authors that you look at, are they more specific when they discuss medicinal food versus simple food? Or are they equal?
No, they speak about all what people eat. So they speak of nutritional food and also medicine food, but in the same way, in a way. But they want to prevent people that this kind of food you eat, for instance, fruit, if you not cook them before, and in middle age there is a long habit of cooking fruit, using in recipes, but also cooked food. It's a way to prevent illness and to inform the people that eating fruit which is not cooked is a potential danger for health. But in a way, they don't. Food is everywhere in medical treaties, in treaty written for health, regimina sanitatis, but also, as I show you in concilia, in practica, in commentaries, food is on the way nutrition, and on the other way, the first of the medicine, before pharmacopoeia, because it's less dangerous to eat food like a medicine, that medicine with a problem of dosage. So you can find food everywhere in all the medieval, but also ancient literature, because there is an heredity, of course, of the traditional Greek medicine and Arabic medicine. I'm not sure I answered.
Yeah, well, I can ask you more later.
Thank you so much. I don't know any Latin, but really learned a lot. Can I ask you if you presented towards the end these texts from different cultures coming into Latin, translated into Latin, and then the last page you had all these texts for elites, for the nobles, the rich families. Would you suggest that this was really a top-down concept of gastronomy and food as medicine, or medicine coming from food? Or would you say that it really was across society, and that while this was written down for the elite, that people who couldn't write were also feeling and believing and living this concept?
Of course, they say health is a luxury. Because this kind of people can choose what they eat, the other people don't. They eat what they farm, but they can pay. So the problem is not the same. Even if some kind of text, like the one I show you, it's of course an illuminated manuscript, but we found some other manuscripts are not illuminated. And not this one, sorry. The one of from the British Library, Aldobrandien de Sienne, this kind of text was written in French, for instance, or written in English, or written in Italian. Sometimes you can find them with a kind of note of possession. And I have found one, for instance, of Aldobrandien in the National Library in Paris, in which the owner was, people who makes bread. Baker of Dijon in Burgundy. So sometimes there is a kind of democratization, and also with the print book after in the 1470s, 1480s, with this kind of text begin to be print. So the audience could be a little bit wider than it was before, but of course all these practitioners were also practitioners of these aristocratic rulers. So they work for them, and they want kind of text that could interest them also to be supported by these laws to have to be employed for that by them. So there is a.
Are we reaching that point in time where we conclude this very interesting panel and think about lunch, but not before we thank Marilyn and all the others.